Hello, welcome to Scopes Screencasts. Today we are going to talk about how to interface with C, how pointers work, casting, gonna look at structs and unions, and how to disassemble functions. So let's say we wrote a function that does some vector arithmetic, and we want to know how performant it is. I'm going to write my own dot product function, which takes the dot product of two vectors and returns it. Going to test if it works. And there we go. And I would now like to know how well my function works, how performant it is. I know a bit of assembly, I understand a bit of LLVM intermediate code, and I would like to see how my implementation is faring. So the first thing I'm going to do is to typify my function for the arguments that I want to put in. If I look at the generated label, I see that it's returning a float, and I can look at the at Scopes intermediate code to see what operations would take place. There's some element extractions, three multiplications, two additions, and that's the function. So if we compile that one, we can compile the function directly in Scopes and execute it. The problem is that we have to extract the correct signature from the function before we can use it, because usually you're not supposed to compile individual functions and then use them, because you lose some of the advantages of not having fixed function boundaries. For example, if this function is used in a larger context, then it can often be inlined or completely removed if your input arguments are constant. And as soon as you manually compile a function, you get a C function pointer, which always expects arguments to be passed in this way. So this is only for profiling and debugging. So first we have, if we want to test F, we have to first cast it to a type that is known at compile time. So we are going to cast it to a function pointer type that returns a float and takes two vectors, and then we can execute it finally, and it works as expected. So without actually executing it, we can definitely look at I'm going to put this in a block, comment auto block for now. And we can look at what the generated intermediate code for that looks like for LLVM by passing an extra argument, a symbol called dump function. So what we see here is the code that LLVM code generator generates in the background, and it looks pretty much like the Scopes intermediate format that we looked at earlier, minus all the continuation passing annotations. And you see that it's performing a lot of extractions, multiplications, additions, where maybe the disassembly looks a little bit better. Also, we can apply a maximum optimization by passing an O3 symbol, which didn't make anything better. There have been some small modifications that make no big difference. So let's look at the disassembly, which is the final machine code that is actually being executed. So we see a lot of SSE statements, which are nevertheless not grouping our arguments. So all this could be a lot better. We basically want to get rid of all these SS statements, which only operate on single floats and get generally less instructions. Just cut down on the number of instructions we need to execute. So since our input arguments are already vectors, we can make use of the fact that you can group vector operations in a single instruction. So we are going to multiply A and B, and then just sum up the individual components of the solution. So we see that it still works, but our disassembly has gotten considerably shorter. We couldn't get rid of the two final additions here, but we are seeing that only a single multiplication is now required, since everything happens in a single register. And our LLVM implementation has probably also gotten shorter, so look at that. Let's look at that. And yep, it's also a lot less generated code. So what is this S operator that you are looking at here? This is the way you do casts in scopes. All hard casts, which are, scopes has two types of casts, the soft cast, which is implicitly tried, and the hard cast, which you are always triggering explicitly with S. And the soft cast, every type can implement both cases. A type can accept to soft cast to much fewer types than it can be hard casted. So if you design a type, you can always guide how much you want to have done implicitly and explicitly. And in this case, we are constructing a new type, which is first we construct a function type that returns float and passes and accepts two VEC3 arguments, and then we define a pointer to that function, and then we say that we want to cast F to this type. This syntax is inspired by Rust. I like the way that you could use infix operators to chain several casts, which is something you occasionally need. For example, if you have a pointer type like, let's try this out here. If you have a pointer type, which is then stored as pointer with function storage and a reference. So a reference to a pointer with function storage, and you want to cast that one to the underlying value that it points to. You can always cast such a value if it supports it to immutable, and then you are getting the actual value that it's there, which is then once again an immutable value. and you can then continue to cast the value to something else, for example, an unsigned 8-bit value. And this way you can chain several casts next to each other. In general, you don't use pointers directly a lot. You mostly operate with references, and references, pointers are a storage type, and references use pointers as storage type, and then add a lot of implicit and automatic functionality on top, so they become as transparent as possible and you can work with them and mostly ignore that they are actually pointers. For example, if you assign, you can assign a new value here to x because you declined it as var, and this assignment is a special operator that is implemented by references, and this comparison here does then also first try to softcast the left value to the same type as the right one, which is also implemented by the reference, and by that way you barely notice that the underlying storage type is a stack pointer. We can look at how references are implemented in core. It's pretty advanced code, but it gives you an impression of what kind of things you could do with metaprogramming, which is the subject of the next talk. Takes a bit of work to make a reference feel convenient. Here's how the var declaration is implemented. So this is also completely implemented in language. And you can also here see that var supports a second syntax where you can directly declare runtime sized arrays on the stack, which we are not going to get into right now because it's something you rarely need. It's often used in interfacing with C functions, which is something that we are going to talk about in this talk. And the next subject is structs and unions. You can declare your own C-compatible structs in scopes, and they can also be used as a replacement for C++ classes. They are basically a set of syntax sugar for declaring type names and assigning type functions in a way that feels more familiar to when you are coming from C, C++, or Terra. So the way you declare a struct is like this. And then you can declare struct elements, named struct elements that are typed as, first you type the name of the element. Well, let's make something useful. Let's make a linked list entity. So the first element of this list element is a value that we want to store, and we're going to just do a regular integer. And the second value is the next list element, and this is a pointer type. And this is our first struct. So we can instantiate a list element without initializing anything by default, by just calling the underlying type, and then we are getting a new element. Or we can initialize it right away with two values, for example, 0 and null. And then we can look at the contents of the declared element. And because you can see here that the first element is zero as we initialized it, and the second element is also zero, which is declared as an immutable pointer to a list element. And because I declared it via let, this entry is now immutable. So if we wanted to make a mutable list element, we would declare it as var. Then it would be possible to change the attribute afterwards. You could then declare it as empty, then initialize the members manually. And let's see if we can set the next pointer to the element itself, which would be a legal operation. Yeah, we can. But an easier way to initialize the value, especially if you don't want to change it again, which is often more efficient and easier to optimize for, is to assign the individual values in the constructor. Scopes functions support key values, named arguments, and I think I called them keyed arguments, and you can then pass the initializer you want to pass directly in the constructor. So this works too, and that's how structs work. So what if we want to make the first list element more like we want to make more of a scheme like a linked list that takes, that accepts different types for the first argument? For that we can use we can make a union, which is also implemented via the struct syntax. You could say the struct syntax is basically like a small domain-specific language just to declare structs, and the union is a variation of that, because unions almost work the same as structs in C. We are just reusing the syntax for this, and you could then also use it in the same way. So let's say we have an int value and a real value. We want to store either one of both in the head, and then we still need a name for that, don't we? Let's call this the header, and then we would have to initialize the head like this. And that works. So what about circular types? Types where you want, structs where you want to reference. We want to also make it possible to have sublists, but the list element is declared here. So if I type something like list value and declare it as a list element, we are going to get a syntax error, because at this point, list element is not declared yet. How are we going to solve it? The first problem is that we didn't do a pointer. We tried to pull it directly in, which isn't possible anyway. And this actually worked. Well, that's strange. Actually, this isn't supposed to work, so I'm a bit surprised. I wanted to create a case where you had to do a forward declaration. So I don't know why this works right now. Maybe the language is better than I thought. But if you have the need for a forward declaration before the struct is actually constructed, you can declare within the same scope the struct like this, and that acts as a forward declaration. So at a later point, you can then fill in what's actually in the struct and start using it for pointers. Okay, let's import some C. There's a built-in function that gives you a direct bridge to the Clang C/C++ compiler. And you can use that one to pull in any external C library. One C library that exists on every computer is the standard C library. So we are going to use some functions from that one. We use the import C built-in function. And the first argument is always the the name our source file would have in the C system. We have to specify some name here, and these names shouldn't collide. And so we're going to pick demo.c for that one. This also controls how the next part is being passed. The next part is a multi-line string where we declare some C. If I wrote CPP here, then the following multi-line string would be interpreted as a C++ file, which means that if you want to export anything that can be used from scopes, you have to put it in external C brackets. But for now, let's just do the C part, and we're going to include the function that contains printf, which is in standard io.har. So I'm going to write an include here. I could also format this in a bit more readable way. And the next part is a list of options. Usually you would pass something here like an include path, but standard include paths are already included, so we don't need that right now. So we're just gonna put an empty list here. So let's try that out. That worked. By convention, I always call the standard C dependency C. And now we can directly start using functions that we pulled in via the include. So printf is now available. You see the function signature here. You can see here that it takes an immutable pointer, which is a const pointer, and variable arguments, and then returns a number, which is the number of characters that have been printed. And we can now use this function directly. So let's run that, and we should be seeing hello world. So how efficient is this? Let's say this is our main function. We are printing hello world and then returning zero. And wanna compile this. Main doesn't take any arguments, so we don't have to typify with any types. We're gonna compile this, and we want to look at the generated LLVM module code. So what we're seeing is some debug symbols, and this is the actual body of the function. Defines printf as x as an external function, and then calls it with internal pointer to our string here, casts it correctly, and then returns nothing, which is because we are returning a constant number, which is always being dissolved. So if we really want to return at zero, we have to unconst it. So that's a very simple C interface. You can also pull in all kinds of types, and you can even write your own functions. For example, I can write a C function here that performs the printf there. And then I can call it from here. forgot the backslash. Whoop. Yeah, it gets more complicated if you want to do it like that. So that's not... This is mostly useful for when you need to do some... For example, there are some symbols that are only implemented as... Some functions that are only implemented as macro, and you need those macros to work outside of the C context, then you can wrap them in functions that then call the function, the macros, and do the work for you. So this is one way to use this. And of course, all types that you define here, are then also available . So K is also available now, and you can also use it, since it's a struct, you can use it exactly in the same way that you saw how we defined structs earlier. But there's of course also the case where you want to import a precompiled shared library and use that one. And I'm going to show you some examples that I wrote for the game engine that I'm working on. So here's a here's another example for simple C library import. I'm doing two includes, and then because standard out is macro function on Windows but an external symbol on Linux, I have a wrapper function that makes sure that it's always a function, and then I import this library directly into my local scope. There's an extra unmentioned feature for using that allows to filter the imported names with a regular expression. And then I bind the functions to new names and export that one. But what if we have an external library? For example, I wrote my own I compiled my own library that contains a bunch of single header libraries like dir, emgui, and imgui, and some custom stuff, and forgot what else. I think nanovg is in there. So for this case, it's possible to use load library for this. If you have declared any symbols via import C, and you have first loaded the library for those declarations, then all these imports can be found. So in this case, we have a conditional block that basically works like an ifdef. That would work like an ifdef macro declaration in C. We're checking at compile time if the operating system is Windows, and if yes, we are going to load a DLL, and otherwise we are going to load a shared object. And there's a built-in symbol that is always available, which is a string to the current module's execution path, so we can easily import files relative to the module's location in the path. And here are some more elaborate bindings. This is bindings for OpenGL, where you see the standard pattern, a standard pattern where I first import the correct shared object, the correct library, and then I import the header for it. So in this case, you see I generated the GL C functions with glad. I'm merely including that header, and here I set the include paths for that module. And then I'm importing all functions that start with a lowercase or uppercase GL, and this also includes all macros. Yeah, this is also something I didn't tell you yet. If you have defined any, if there are any values defined as macros, like float values and integer values, if they are very simple, then they can be imported. So all these should work. Yep. So for macros, it's difficult to say what type they have or how they are defined. So by default, it always goes for the highest type, and you can easily recast them to the type you really need using the ASCAST. Oops. Oh, there's some work left for me to do. It's possible that it doesn't allow a direct conversion. If nope. Okay, that's some work for me. All right. So what's left? Yeah, I think we have covered pretty much everything for this talk. Yeah, see you next time.